Hello and welcome. Today is May 20th, 2019, and this is County Connections. I will be your host for this show, and my name is Jonathan Del Collo. I am the Prothonotary of Berks County. A fancy title with a lot of fancy responsibilities. Not really, but very important responsibilities. I was here about a month ago on April 23rd, and we talked about the office, about what we did, some history of the office, how the office was created, a little bit about our first Prothonotary, James Reed. We also touched on some of the important filings that we do that I want to elaborate more on this evening, and those mainly were PFAs, protection from abuse, and also I got a little bit into our historical records, specifically our immigration and naturalization records. And tonight, I think we're going to delve more into those because a lot of genealogists in Berks County and beyond Berks County are very interested in them. So we'll talk a little bit about them tonight. And I brought an example, and we'll show you what these records, how these records can really help genealogists and historians to break down brick walls and to help enable them to continue their research outside the United States to a mother country, the old country. So we also have a big announcement, which I'll make at the end, about my office. So looking forward to that. One of the main things that we my goal as Prothonotary is to give access to as much information that we have in our office to the citizens of Berks County and our other users without having to come into the courthouse. Some things you have to come into the courthouse for, of course, but we established our electronic filing and some other paperless features that enable users to be able to file and to use our office from the comfort of their home or their home office. On that line, if you go to our website, which is www.countyofberks.com/prothonotary, we have the first menu item is search our dockets, because a lot of people call us, a lot of people come in and they say, I need to look something up. I want to look my name up to see if I have any liens. We talked about that at the last show, that my office files liens, municipal liens, state tax liens, federal tax liens, any type of lien, unemployment compensation liens. And people come into the office all the time where they call us and they say, I'd like to look up my name to see if I have any liens. Well, you can do that if you have an internet connection, or if you don't, you can do it from the Reading Public Library or another institution that has internet connection. Most people do them from their smart devices, their iPhones or their Android phones or their tablets. And you can access our dockets from your mobile device or from your home computer. The first link on our website is search our dockets. So if you click that, you'll be able to search all of our dockets from 1996 currently, 23 years. It covers a real big gamut of the current populace in Berks County, 1996 to current. Our dockets are updated real time. So if you're looking at a docket from your home and we have a filing that goes to that case and you refresh your computer, you will see that new filing immediately. So our dockets are updated real time. And it's a really good resource because a lot of people come, they're able to look in the comfort of their own home, or if they can't sleep at night, or if they're on the weekend and it's raining and their plans are ruined and they want to do some type of research when the courthouse is closed, they can search our dockets, put their name in. If they're already involved in a case and they want to see the progress of it, they can also do that. They cannot see the images, though. You could just see our dockets, and our dockets are pretty descriptive. So a lot of times you can figure out what's going on with the case, with the current status of the case, by simply reading the docket. If you do want to look at the image, you can do that in our office. The Supreme Court of Pennsylvania has instituted a rather semi-restrictive policy on access to records now because of all the identity theft and stolen identities that's been going on in the country. and around the world, quite frankly. So you do have to provide some, if you do want some family case information, divorce, custody, that involves filling out a request for access form. But you can look at a lot of the images in our office if you want to look at the actual documents or make copies or get certified copies. But a lot of people just want to search the dockets. And you can do that now from your home through our website. People also request divorce decrees. They need divorce decrees for their Social Security. Or they have a former spouse that they're divorced from and they need a copy of their spouse's of their divorce decree so they can get some Social Security benefits that were that they're enabled, entitled to, that from their spouse. So they come into our office all the time for divorce decrees. You can do them through the mail as well, but you do need to fill out a request for access form. A link is provided on our website, and you also need to provide identity, a photo ID. We can release unredacted copies of these divorce decrees to the parties in the case. So if you're the plaintiff or the defendant and you want a copy of your own divorce decree, we'll certainly give you an unredacted copy, but you do need to provide us proof that it's you. We've had problems with people from outside the area. They want to research a person, a neighbor, a former neighbor, find out the intricacies of their divorce case or their custody case. They come in or they write us and I want access to all these divorce records, but they're not the party. Now, in that instance, we will give them access, but we will redact out confidential information as laid out by the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania so that they're not trying to do anything bad with that information. So divorce decrees, another big document request that people come into the office for or write us. On the same lines of that are custody orders. Sometimes moms or dads, they need a copy of it. They misplaced or they need another copy of a custody order from a custody case that they had in our court. So they come in to pick that up. Same circumstances apply. If it's mom or dad, they're parties in the case. They can get unredacted copies of the custody orders, which can be very, very sensitive and have a lot of very sensitive information because a lot of times they list birth dates, children's names, stuff like that we do not want to get out to anybody but mom or dad or the parties in the case. A lot of times people also come to the office for copies of satisfactions of liens. So they had a tax lien or they had a municipal lien and they paid it off. And the authority that granted the lien or that placed the lien on the person sent us documentation satisfying that lien. So people want to come into our office, get a copy. It's usually sent to them by the authority that put the lien on, but not always. So they want to come in and get a copy of that lien for their personal records to show that they paid it off. So people do come into the office a lot for that. And we welcome you to come into the office. Of course, you can still, through the website, check the docket and see that the lien was satisfied, and you can print off a docket summary of the case if you do not want the actual document saying that you're satisfied the lien. A docket, a lot of times, will suffice for your personal records just to show that it was paid off. But you can always come into the office to get a copy of the satisfaction if you need it. Okay, so that's a little bit about the types of documents, what people really come to the office for, and I'd like to get into another big aspect of what we do in the office, and that are protection from abuse orders. Berks County, it's my understanding that, unfortunately, we're number 3 in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania with the amount of protection from abuse orders filed. I don't know why that is. Number one, of course, Philadelphia County. Philadelphia is also a city and a county. A lot of people don't know that. It's a county as well as a city. Number two, county, of course, Allegheny, which incorporates the city of Pittsburgh. And Berks County, unfortunately, is number 3 of the 67 counties in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Protection from abuse orders, ever since I've been with the office of the Prothonotary, and I was elected 2 years ago, but I was with the office since 2006, I think we've always been number three. I don't know what it is about Berks County that there's so many protection orders granted or sought, but it's very disappointing, it's very distressing, but it's something that we need to pay special attention to and help the victims seeking relief come to the office, as well as the defendants who are defending themselves against allegations of abuse. We don't decide. A lot of times people come in and they try to tell us their case. We are not judges. Excuse me. We aren't judges. We're just file. We just file the documents. We're, as I like to tell people, we're kind of like an umpire, a judge. A judge in like a sporting event. We have to see it right down the middle. We cannot play favorites to either side in a protection from abuse case. We just need to make sure that there's resources available for both sides. Protection orders are very important. And there's certain types of people that can obtain a protection from abuse order. There's also a restraining order, which is a criminal type document, and I don't want to get into that, but there are certain types of people that can apply for a protection from abuse order, and those include a spouse or a former spouse of the defendant or someone who lived as spouses with the defendant, a parent of a common child with the defendant. So if the plaintiff and the defendant have a child, the parent could apply. A current or a former sexual or intimate partner of the defendant, or someone who shares biological parenthood with the defendant. The defendant, when I speak of defendant in this case, is the defendant is the person who the alleged victim is seeking protection from. The parent of a defendant may seek relief for a PFA. A child of a defendant may seek relief. And any family member who is related by blood or marriage to the defendant can seek relief. So it's like, so if your neighbor is harassing you or threatening to hurt you, that does not fall under the guidelines of a protection from abuse order. That would be a restraining order, and that's a criminal matter, which my office does not handle. Although some people think protections from abuses are a criminal, there's a whole debate about that, but we're just fine filing them in our office. People will ask me, what kind of a relief can a protection from abuse order provide? Well, it can restrain a defendant from abusing, stalking, harassing the plaintiff or the minor children or any other protected persons. It can prohibit the defendant from having any contact with the plaintiff, minor children, or other protected persons, including their places of employment, business, or school. It can evict or exclude the defendant from the residence. It could restore possession of the residence to the plaintiff or provide suitable alternative housing to the plaintiff. That is very important. That is a very important. If you have a couple that's living together, and one of them files a protection order against the other, the judge in granting a protection order could evict the defendant from the house. They would have to find a new place to live until the order expires. Very, very powerful. Other relief that could be provided is award temporary custody or establish temporary visitation rights with regard to minor children. Payment of temporary support for plaintiff or the minor children could be sought. Reimburse the plaintiff for out-of-pocket financial losses suffered as a result of the abuse. And also, this is a big one, and it's been in the news lately. It could require the defendant to temporarily relinquish any firearms, weapons, or other ammunition that they might own to the sheriff's office, and prohibit the defendant from transferring, acquiring, or possessing them for the duration of the order. And some of our PFA orders are for 3 years. So it's very powerful. And it should be, because you want the victims or the plaintiffs that are judged by the judge to have been victimized or abused, you want them to be safe. So you don't want defendants to have the weapons. So PFA is very powerful. How do you get one if you think you might need one? The PFA office is on the first floor of the Berks County Services Center, not the courthouse. I always call the Services Center the big blue building. The old courthouse is the old courthouse. It's staffed Monday through Friday from 8 to 5, but the PFA filing hours are from 8 to 2. So if you think you might need a PFA on a certain day, try to arrive to the PFA office by 1 p.m. If not, if you need to come in after 1, the staff can help you with applying for an emergency PFA petition with the magisterial district judge that's on duty that day. So if it's after 1, don't think you have to wait for another whole day before you can come in. You can come in and get an emergency PFA, but then you'll have to come back the next day for the regular PFA process. So PFA is very important. If you think you might need protection, please don't stay and keep putting up with the abuse. Please seek relief from the courts. That's why we have the PFA law. Please don't wait any longer. Don't put yourself or your children in danger. Please come to PFA office and seek relief. And everybody will be glad to help you out. And so will our staff as well. Okay. The last thing before we say goodbye tonight is the biggest type of document that people come to my office for, historians and genealogists, and those are naturalization petitions or naturalization records. And I don't want to get into a long and boring soliloquy about them. I could talk probably 2 or 3 hours about them because they're so interesting. But genealogists come to our office because they provide so many vital details about a person and their family. And I have an example here. Before a person wanted to become an American citizen, they need to declare their intention to become an American citizen. So I have the petition here of a gentleman known as Paride Liardi. He's from Italy. And he was also known as Patsy Liardi. Well, on this petition, it not only lists Patsy's complexion or his height, his weight, his hair color, where he was born in Italy, when he was born. It says that he has a wife. It gives his wife's birth date. It gives where his wife was born. It gives where they were married. It gives their marriage date. And it also lists, at that time they had no children, and I don't know if he went on to have children. But if he had children, they would be listed as well. It also gives information on when he immigrated to America and from where. In this case, he came to America from, he immigrated from Naples, Italy, which was a big port that Italians came to America from. He came to America on a ship called the SS Argentina, that he arrived in the United States on June 12, 1920, and that his port of entry was New York, New York. Now, as we all know, New York, New York from 1892 until it closed, I think in the 40s, was Ellis Island. So when you, and I've had people actually get teary-eyed and almost weep when they see that their ancestor came through Ellis Island, because it puts the whole American story, the whole immigrant story into a perfect perspective. I mean, then you start to have the images. My own family came through Ellis Island, and you start to have the images of them sailing past the Statue of Liberty, and the ship docking, and going through the Ellis Island process station, and getting on trains to come to eventually Reading or to wherever else they were heading to in the United States. So it's pretty powerful. It also lists, a lot of times it'll give a picture of the immigrant as well. So you can see here Patsy, pretty sharp looking guy. I think it says he was a barber, so pretty sharp. Wonderful source of genealogical information. And because it gives his date of birth and his place of birth, which a lot of times are very, very accurate, ancestors, his progeny here in America, are now able to research his family in Italian records, which I did for myself. And sometimes the generations can go back into the 1600s. So they're very, very powerful records. And thank goodness that they were provided for, that the, I think it was the Labor Department was in charge of the immigration and naturalization at the time, because they're a wonderful, wonderful resource. Okay, in our remaining minutes, I want to give some contact information here. This is my homemade special sign. To get to the office, well, I always tell everybody to please visit our website. It's www.countyofberks.com/prothonotary. Our office number, 610-478-6970. If you would like to talk to me personally, my extension, my direct extension is 3456. Without a doubt, probably the easiest extension in the courthouse. We also have a Facebook page. I'm getting into social media. Facebook.com/BerksProthy. If you'd like to take a look at our Facebook page, our Facebook page is going to be more and more active. I have been putting some old records and some other information on there. We also put information on about closures or anything like that in our office. We're on Twitter too. So if you're on Twitter, it's @BerksProthy is our Twitter handle. And if you would like to email me, jdelcollo@countyofberks.com. jdelcollo@countyofberks.com. Lastly, my big announcement is we're really moving in with the social media, and we're going to be releasing a mobile app for the Prothonotary's office in the coming, probably within a month. So you'll be able to access all of these wonderful things, make passport appointments, make appointments, or put search genealogical record requests in, other great stuff. So please be on the lookout for our mobile app, which will be coming. We will also be launching a YouTube channel to provide more information to the citizens and to show them a lot of our historic records. We're really excited about it. If you're in the courthouse, please stop by, visit. We'd love to say hello to you. And thanks again to BCTV for hosting, and we say good night. Thank you.